everybody. I am Rhea N2RJ, and here with another edition of where we answer your questions. So this is a weekly feature where I will take a question that commonly newer hams or maybe even experienced hams would ask, and then I would answer it here on the video. So today's question, somebody asks if I have coax on my HF station, RG58 coax, is it worth upgrading to something like LMR400 or maybe RG213 or some kind of lower loss coax? So the answer to that is really kind of not so straightforward, and I'll explain why. But first of all, let me run the raw numbers. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring up a handy coax loss calculator, because the primary factor really in a coax is loss, right? You want to know how much signal you lose when the RF makes a trip up the wire, because nothing is free, of course. What happens is that the coax will absorb the RF energy and turn it into heat slowly as you proceed up the coax. And eventually what would happen is that at some point we'll have a smaller amount of RF at the other end. This varies with frequency, and it varies with the length of the coax, and also varies with the type of coax. Generally, you'd find with RG58, it is a very lossy coax, but for many applications, it's actually not that bad. So let's run the raw numbers. So here we have our coax calculator, and I will put a link in the description and also put a link on screen so you can see it. And it tells you here the types of coax that you're able to calculate with this calculator. So let's go down here. We have the, let's start with the RG58, right? Let's assume that this is a 50-foot length, because that's typically what you'd find where somebody has an antenna outside up on the roof. Perhaps it's a little longer, but it's a good starting point. And let's say they have a dipole outside, maybe in the trees, 50 feet. It'll give you from the shack to the trees, okay? 50 feet, and let's say you're going, let's start with a lower band. So let's say you want to go with 75 meters, right? 3.8 megahertz. And we're assuming SWR is 1:1. Of course, that is not true. A lot of times, I dare say most of the time. And the power is 100 watts, meaning your typical HF rate. Calculate. And here you have the results on the right side. You have a match loss of 0.355 dB, SWR loss of 0 dB, because we're not putting in a higher SWR. So you'll have a total loss of 0.355 dB. So you lose about 3 to 4 tenths of a dB of signal. Interesting thing is that if you put 100 watts in that wire, you will end up with 92.158 watts, or about, less, you know, 92 watts, which really is respectable. I mean, it's really not a big loss. You know, you lose 8 watts. Nobody's going to notice that on the other end. Let's change up some of these parameters. Let's go with 7 megahertz. Let's go with 7 megahertz. Okay, so 7 megahertz is a 40 meter signal. Let's go with 7.1. Let's go with 7.2 megahertz. And load SWR 1:1, power 100 watts. Calculate. Notice things start to get a little more lossy, but you still have about 0.5 dB of loss, and you end up with 89.261 watts on the power out. Still respectable, still not bad. Let's go up to 20 meters. I'm using the popular HF bands. I'm not really going to show each and every HF band. So we go up to 14 megahertz, calculate. Got about 0.7 dB, 85 watts. Let's repeat that for 21.2 megahertz, which is the phone segment of 15 meters, 81 watts. So you're losing about 19 watts in RG58. It becomes noticeable. And let's say we go up to 10 meters now. 10 meters, we go 28.4 megahertz. You lose about 21 watts, 20, you know, and 1 dB. Let's say for kicks, you go up to 6 meters, 50.313. Let's say you're running FT8. Calculate, 72.669 watts. So you lose quite a bit of power. Now you notice I'm talking about power. I'm not really talking about signal, because on HF, you're really not concerned too much about the signal that's entering your radio from your antenna. And for good reason. I mean, there is just so much noise on HF. It's really not going to make a difference if you have a few tenths of a dB or even 1 to 2 dB of signal loss down a coax. I mean, it's really not going to make a difference for most people. In fact, some antennas are deliberately lossy and they lose RF to eliminate noise, right? But that's another video. Okay. So we did with the RG58. Let's go back and let's go back to 3.5 megahertz, 3.8 megahertz, which is 75 meters. And you have this nice figure. Let's just say you have an antenna high up in the trees. You go to 100 feet. Things begin to get a little more lossy. Okay, so it's a little significant there. It's not, you know, it's not game changing, but it's still significant. Let's change this RG58 to something like RG213, right? Which is a popular coax from, well, it says wireman here. Well, you know, basically any RG213. So you have 100 feet, a 3.8 megahertz, 100 watts. It makes a bit of a difference. It's not much, and you're really not going to notice it. But let's just try this now at 14 megahertz. Let's skip up the band to 14 megahertz. Right? And 3. Yeah, you still lose a little bit at 14 megahertz on 20 meters. Let's try for 28.4. Calculate. You see? Let's do a comparison, direct comparison with the RG58 now. Right? The Belvin 9201, I think, is what we used. Right. And it was the 8240? Yeah. So you see, you're losing quite a bit of power. It's almost 2 dB you're losing with the Belden 8240 versus the RG213. And, you know, it's really up here that it becomes significant. So that's just one consideration. So there is the raw loss, but there is also something else. There is also the, you have to consider as well the power handling capability. So you have to consider with RG8 that it has approximately 300 volts potential and about 1800 watts, right? Really, it's kind of like on the edge of what, you know, you'd get for legal limit amateur service. And with the RG213, let's see, Belden 8267, and you have the power rating at 1 megahertz, you could go all the way up to 9,295 watts, and at 10 megahertz, which you could go up to 2,761. Notice at 6 meters, it tops out at 1,1122. Let's go with times microwave LMR 400. And the LMR 400 power rating is about, I would say, about 2,100 watts. So, I mean, the RG58 tends to be not as suitable for high power. And that's just one consideration. I mean, loss is one consideration. You have the power handling is another consideration. Cost is another consideration. The RG58 is lower cost. So it might just be all you need. But, you know, and it's very popular for mobile installations where you're in a car and you need that thin coax to pass through a car. I mean, there are some people who have RG8 and RG213 in their cars, and we wouldn't go there. My friend Andrea has runs of LMR 400 in the Rover, and that's quite an interesting vehicle. So it's a very, very straightforward comparison with the signal loss. I mean, I have hard line in my installation because I have 300 feet or so of cable run on each of my antennas, and I would lose quite a bit of power. It'll be wasted going up the coax. So I put 7/8-inch hard line and 1 5/8-inch hard line. It's very expensive, but it was worth it to me. So I can have the 1500 watts from the amplifier go all the way up. Pretty much most of it goes up to the antenna. The other thing you have to consider too is electrical characteristics. These thinner coaxes, they might be more likely to get nicked and damaged. Whereas if you have something like an RG213, the jacket's a little thicker and you can, it offers a little more protection. The hardline is fantastic. It's very durable. I mean, the shell, the outer shell is basically solid copper. So it's really, you know, it's copper alloy, I think, or copper plated, but it's really not going to suffer any elements. And that's a consideration of why many people use hardline as well. Of course, we're not getting into fancy cables like gas injected and, you know, gas filled, nitrogen filled coaxes. All right, so that answers that question. And I'll come back with one more about how we used to do elections in Trinidad. I know that's been a fan favorite on Twitter, and I'll talk a little bit about that. So maybe this belongs in a stories episode, but maybe I should tell you about how we do elections in Trinidad and Tobago. And as you know, we did have, or are still having, I hope we come to an end to this soon because we need to really heal our country here in the United States, elections, general elections to decide for president, to decide for the Senate and the House of Representatives. And by the way, whoever wins, I just hope that they govern well, and I wish them well. So in Trinidad and Tobago, when we had elections, we actually used paper ballots for all of them. And we had one experiment with voting machines, and that was promptly canceled when the ruling party basically won every seat. Or so I was told by my dad. And they basically decided that no more voting machines because it's fraud, fraudulent. And maybe they were right, maybe they were not. So those are gone. So what they do now is they manually count returns, and it's a very tedious process. My dad was a poll worker in Trinidad and Tobago, and he would have to take out each vote and then show it to each of the poll, the witnesses there, and they have the police, of course, with their big machine gun, just in case, I don't know. But they were there, and their witnesses to certify the ballot. If the ballot got smudged, it would be rejected, spoiled ballot. somebody did not vote for one candidate, they voted for more than one, that would get spoiled as well. Anyway, how does ham radio fit into this? Well, ham radio was used as the primary means up until, I don't know when, but the local amateur radio society, the Trinidad and Tobago Amateur Radio Society, was contracted, you know, basically hired, not for compensation, but more as a volunteer effort to relay elections results. Ham radio was a free way to communicate. The telephone toll charges are were substantial. I mean, you're looking at something like 25 cents a minute, US dollars, essentially, to call between the south end of the country and Port of Spain, the capital city. Probably higher. I can't remember exactly how, but I know the toll charges did rack up. The phone company was a monopoly. They were run by cable and wireless and partnership with the government. And we had to use amateur radio to communicate these results because a lot of these polling places also didn't have accessible telephones. And of course, there was no internet. So no internet, no broadband, no Wi-Fi, no nothing. We lived in the dark ages. And you would have hams set up at the polling stations, and they would then get the results from the poll clerk, and then they would relay them onward to the elections offices, and they would get the results that way. The news media would get a feed of that results, and they would then use that to report it on national television, on national radio, and that went for quite a while. What did we use? We use 2 meter FM. We use the local repeaters, which was primarily how most hams in the country would operate. So yeah, generally if you're a local ham, you operate on 2 meters on the TTARs, Trinidad Tobago Amateur Radio Society repeaters. And that was a very good use of amateur radio back then. I don't know if here in the United States it would be considered commercial, but we didn't make any money from it. Maybe because it's helping the government, it would be considered non-commercial. But then again, you know, we live in the year 2020 where we have internet, we have Wi-Fi, broadband. So there really isn't any need to have this sort of thing. But it was very nice that amateur radio played a part in democracy and in having free and fair elections and ensuring that the news media and the government also got all of the results that were up to date. And the cool thing was, if you had a scanner, well, the scanners were illegal, but if you had a receiver to receive the 2 meter band, you could hear the results being called before time. You could hear the results being passed on, and then maybe like, 30 seconds later, the TV commentators would have the results on screen. That's an interesting election story. And that's all for this week. Thank you everyone for watching. Thank you for all the subscribers. Please, if you haven't subscribed already, consider subscribing. It helps encourage me to make more videos. And I really want to keep bringing these to you because I believe I have a lot of knowledge to share. And please give me a like. And please tell your friends. I am Rhea, N2RJ73.